So thankful that you've tuned in. We have for our background scene the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in the rapture. Are you ready to meet him in the clouds? This is the Shekinah glory. This is what our program is all about. Teaching about the glory of Christ and his coming for his saints and our inheritance in him. So in the book of Ephesians, we're learning our inheritance. Also in John chapter 13 through chapter 17. So here we have the very first verse, the key verse to the book of Ephesians is blessed, Ephesians 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. All spiritual blessings. The one thing that we see in the book of Ephesians and the book of Colossians is they embody the highest revelation that God has given to man. The revelation concerns the body of Christ, the fullness of that body, its rich privileges, and heavenly destiny. And we see in verse 7, and this is one of the greatest, greatest books, and we must study these six chapters to know all that we have in Christ. So verse 7 says, in whom ye have redemption through his blood, this is what Jesus Christ has done for us, the forgiveness of sin according to the riches of his grace. According to the riches. And then in verse 18, that the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of our calling and the riches of the glory of the inheritance of the saints of God. And then verse chapter 2 in verse 7. This is always, always our theme. That in the ages to come he might show the exceeding grace of his riches, the exceeding great of his riches, in his grace, in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. And then we think about this and we see the riches of his grace. His grace is sufficient for every need. And he's going to have something new in glory every day. We are going to see the Shekinah glory and all the inheritance that he has left for his saints. Let's pray. Our gracious and dear Heavenly Father, we truly rejoice in the inheritance that we have as true believers. We thank thee and praise thee for all that we have in Christ Jesus. Help us to teach this to all of those that have no hope, those precious little children all over the world, those that are on the streets. Help us to reach them in whatever area thou hast called us to serve. And we pray that thou will raise up many people all over the nations that have no hope. And we thank thee that every person that's listening, we're praying for their salvation. As we study this book together, and as we learn all of the treasures that thou dost have for each of us, that our lives will be changed eternally. Thank thee for hearing and answering our prayers. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So the first inheritance that we had was humility. So we see pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Proverbs 16:18. For every person that has pride, they are going to fall, according to God's word, because that's what happened to Satan. Satan fell from heaven because of his pride. He was full of pride. So what is humility? Humility is perfect quietness. It is to have no trouble. It is never to be fretted or irritated or sore or displeased. It is to expect nothing, to wonder at nothing that is done to me. It is to be at rest when nobody praises me and when I am blamed or despised. That's what humility is. You know why? Because this was Christ. He washed the disciples' feet as a servant. And we are to do the same thing. He says, I'm leaving this for you for an example that you are to do the same thing that I have done to you. You see, this is why we always use Christ as our standard, not anybody else. We compare ourselves with Christ, and we will not have any ego, and we will not have pride, because none of us can measure up to him. But we are to desire that. And he said in chapter 13, he said, for I have given to you an example that ye should do as I have done to you. So this is why we must know humility and live this humility. And then we see his love. Now we're just going over these. We are just reviewing what we've already had. So, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. First of all, you put your name, for God so loved you, that he gave his only begotten Son, that if you believe in him, you will never perish. You will never die, because he died instead of you. That's all you have to do, is to believe that. And then he said to love one another as I have loved you. By this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. Now this is in John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35. But then this is the greatest love, the one that laid down his life for us. And this is what we are to do. He loved those that were his enemies. And this is a command to each of us, to love your enemies. Now this is what Christ did, and we are to do the same thing. Love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Matthew 5:44. You must write these verses down, because we are to live what he says. We are to live. He's our example. And then we saw his home. Oh, what a blessing this is. His home. He said, let not your heart be troubled, in John chapter 14. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Now this is why we know the rapture is going to take place, because he said, I am going to come, and I want you to be where I am. And one of the Bible verses that we need to read with this that I didn't read before was John chapter 17, verse 24. And this is what happens to every true child of God. He says, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am. You see, he's going to be there to welcome us into heaven. Now remember, this is a place that I have not seen nor ear heard the glories he has for us. Once I want you to think about this home, all of these gifts that we inherit as true believers didn't cost us anything. Didn't cost us anything. This is why he that spared not his own son, Romans 8:32, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? This home that he has prepared for us is free. We didn't pay for it. We didn't work for it. Eternal life is free. I did not pay for that. And all of these gifts is what he left us before he went back to heaven. And I have not seen nor ear heard the glories he has for us. And then his name, John 14:13-14. John 13:14. This is why we must study his word and know what he has for us. John 14. And this is what he says for you as true believers. You cannot pray to him unless you are a child of God. Unless you have been born again by the Spirit of God, you cannot call him Father. You cannot use his name. He says in verse 13, and whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Now, you know, we show this Bible verse to you all the time. And this is why we say in Christ's name. In Christ's name. You see, Christ is his name now. His earthly name was Jesus. You see, we must pray for one another. He says to pray for all saints. So we are to pray for one another. And then he says, hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. You see, now I can call him Father. I can use his name. Have you asked and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. Once you know his joy, you are never the same person. You can't be the same person. So here he wants us to use his name in honor and reverence. This is why we ask in Christ's name. You see, it is that name that is above every name. The most wonderful person in all the universe, I can use his name. So since prayer is based on relationship, he has left his name with us for us to use in this intimate kinship that he has given to us. And you see, when you sing about him, Psalm 66:1-2, sing forth the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. Singing is in connection with redemption. Moses sang the first song in Exodus. This is a prophetic song in Exodus chapter 15. The last song that Moses has is Revelation 15:3. You must read them. This is complete redemption, the song of the redeemed. In Exodus 15, they had been delivered from the bondage of the Egyptians. Their redemption was by blood and by power, the same as ours. You see, he wants us to have praise and adoration, joy and victory. And then we saw his peace. He said, John 14:27, my peace I give unto you. Now we must realize that not as the world giveth. Remember he said in John 14, and this is one of the messages we must know, verse 27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. My peace I give unto you. It is his peace, not ours. Not as the world. You see, what does the world give us? The world in chapter 16 and verse 33. In the world you shall have tribulation. but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. So he says he wants to give us this peace. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because we trust in thee. So once we have his peace, there is nothing like it. It is his peace for each of us. Although, you know, this is a gift of the Holy Spirit, and we will go into the Holy Spirit today or maybe next week, and then we'll see what the Holy Spirit gives us love, joy, and peace. That's our inward life. Although the world is full of trouble, he says the wicked are like the troubled sea. And we see that today, don't we? And then his life, oh, bearing fruit. This is one of the greatest gifts. Are you bearing fruit? Are you glorifying the Lord? Is your ministry a joy? All of these are what he has left for us as true believers. Your ministry should be the greatest joy in the world. This is the highest calling that anyone can have. So our Lord proceeds in chapter 15 to teach his own that he's leaving. He's going from them, but he's going to leave them. When he is gone from them, they are not to be under the necessity of living without him, but rather in daily dependence upon him. Daily dependence. 15:26. This is what he's going to leave them. He said, but when, chapter 15 of the book of John, verse 26, but when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. So if I am bearing fruit, now this is God's word in chapter 15. We went over this last week. If he says in 1 Corinthians 10:31b, he said in John chapter 15, and remember this is God's word, if I'm not bearing fruit, I'm not glorifying the Lord. If I'm not bearing fruit, he says in verse 8, herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. See, this is his word. I am to bear fruit. And this is why he used the vine and the branch for us, that we could understand what this is in bearing fruit. He said, in a oneness that imparts the greatest reality, and particularly in his continuing relationship with his own. You see, if I have sin, I sever that relationship and I cannot have victory. That's why we cannot sin and have the blessings that God has for us. We have our position in him. Abide in me. Now look and make a study of chapter 15. How many times? I want all of you that are listening to know the one doctrine that you must always understand is the abiding presence of God. The abiding presence. He never leaves us. And my body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Abide in me. That's our possession. And I in you. You see, heaven began when Christ came in. I am in him and he in me. Our power to bear fruit. I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. Without the Spirit of God, this is impossible. No one can bear fruit apart from the Spirit of God. So close and complete in the union with him that the branch and the vine live wholly for each other. That's how we are to do. We are the body of believers. The body of believers are the only true church. For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, and Christ is the head. Now we'll get into that when we get into Ephesians, so you can't miss these lessons, because this is your inheritance as a child of God. Everybody wants to be left something earthly, waiting for someone to die to get their inheritance. That won't do you any good. You're going to die and leave it. Our inheritance is Christ, and Christ is eternal. The branch is dependent on the vine for everything. That is our position, life and fruitfulness. The vine without the branches can bear no fruit. And he says, without me, ye can do nothing. This is one of my prayer verses, John 15:5. I am the vine, ye are the branches. If ye abide in me and I abide in you, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. So I pray for 100-fold that every person that listens will come to know Christ as Savior. And this is his will. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to a knowledge of the Savior, Jesus Christ. It's not his will that you should perish, but every person that's listening. And this is the confidence I have: if I ask anything according to his will, I know he hears, and I shall have the petition I require of him. Christ has shown marvelous condescension in thus limiting himself to work only with our cooperation by prayer and by testimony. How is your testimony? Since our body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, are we glorifying the Lord? Whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. All that the vine possesses belongs to the branches. It does not live for itself, but for the branches that are dependent upon the vine. To end, they possess nothing which does not affect the vine. The branch has no reason for existing but to proclaim the excellency of the vine and to be of service to it, that the vine may be able to minister to the world the desire and purpose that fits the nature of Christ. Does people see Christ in you, or do they see you? Are you daily cultivating the abiding life, doing all possible on your part to render the union vital and practical to bring forth fruit? Is your life in consequence the outliving of the inliving Christ? It's not me that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. His joy, John 15:11. His joy. This is a wonderful, wonderful. I know the joy of the Lord. I live the abundant life. I know what that is. To serve the Lord is the abundant life. To bear fruit is the abundant life. He said, these things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might be full. Is my ministry a joy? This is what others need to see in you. Our Lord's words that it is his joy that he is leaving with us. A joy that has come to be a part of his experiences and part of that now he's passing on to us. He lived. He said, for the joy that was set before me, he endured the cross. Hebrews 12:2, despising the shame. Like his peace, it has stood the test of life in all points. He was tempted like as we are, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. He was despised and rejected. What about you? Have you been despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief? You know, those are his sufferings for us, and that was a joy. What about your sufferings today? He says, in everything give thanks, For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Nehemiah 8:10, the joy of the Lord is your strength. You see, when you have joy, that is health for you. You have joy, joy welling up in your soul through it all. It's making it over to us, everything that he did. The joy that he had in suffering, it even pleased the Lord to bruise him. It pleased the Lord. Are you giving thanks for your sufferings? You see, what joy, what is this joy which our Lord would bring to us, the joy that could live the abundant life? Everything that we are tested and tried with, every trial that we have had, he had them before we were ever born. He knew what adversities and trials and persecutions are. Compare yourself with the beatings that he took. When you think of your trials and you have self-pity, try just to think of the nails that went into his hands that should have been in my hands. The beatings, 39 stripes, with a 12 leather, pieces of leather, with pieces of bone and metal in each one, beaten. He never answered them a word. When he was reviled, he reviled not again. I wonder today, are you ready for the rapture? If you are not ready for the rapture, I want you to call upon the Lord Jesus Christ to save you right now. Next week, we're going to have what he has given us in his spirit. We're going to find out his victory. These are the greatest lessons for every true child of God. And for those without Christ and without hope, they are for you. Because the world is coming to an end. We're not going to get into all that's happening in the Middle East on these lessons. But we're going to have lessons after we get through these to show you that we are close to Armageddon. That means we're going to be raptured before the 7-year tribulation period when the Antichrist is going to be reigning. And if you accept him during the 7-year period when the Antichrist is going to reign, you're going to be martyred for your faith. Today, this is a gift. All you have to do is to call upon him and he will save you. That's his desire.
Way up till the throne, then we'll go and get some more. You bring more.